The principal engineer role varies quite a bit from company to company. At Amazon, for example, a lot of the work that I did was reviewing designs made by other people. At Microsoft, on the other hand, it was more typical for me to help with multi-team projects and helping to come up with the design and architecture of them. Still, reviewing designs even within the team was definitely part of the job. So how do you go about giving a good design review as a principal engineer? What sort of things should you do? Hi, I'm John Miller, the deliberate engineer. I spent 30 years as a software engineer in industry, 15 of those as a principal engineer at Amazon, Microsoft, and Google. Today I'd like to talk about how to do a good design review as a principal engineer. This is something that was asked for by one of my viewers, but unfortunately I lost the comment and I can't seem to track it down. So whoever it was, thanks for the suggestion. A principal engineer is usually a very experienced software engineer who's shipped many products. They've gone through every part of the product lifecycle, from initial conception, design, implementation, and then dealing with the issues that come up afterwards. This experience makes them extremely valuable for helping to spot things that are non-obvious pitfalls in other projects. There's a lot of value to be had by having a principal engineer review software design, especially if it's made by people who haven't already shipped a lot of software and had to live with the consequences of shipping it. A principal engineer design review is very different from a principal engineer design. The objective of a design review isn't to come up with the greatest, best way of doing something. Instead, it's to take a look at a thoughtful design that somebody else created and ask questions, pursue the Socratic method to help people see whether they've really considered all the things they need to consider. If there's something that looks like it hasn't been considered, the principal engineer will ask questions around it to see whether it's something that has already occurred to the designer. If it's something that looks like it may potentially be a problem, again, the principal engineer will ask questions about it to see whether it's something that the designer has already thought about and has addressed elsewhere. A principal engineer should respect the designer's time and the time of everybody else involved in the review by making sure that they read all of the documentation available on that design and come up with their feedback on it before they ever actually get in the design meeting. Among other things, this will help the principal engineer to avoid asking questions only to have them answered later in the very design docs that they are reviewing. This is something that happens more frequently than you might think. In terms of how that feedback is given, the principal engineer should give it in a form that can't be consumed before the actual review itself. Otherwise, they risk getting into a sort of design and review loop with the designer, where as issues are brought up by the principal engineer, the designer tries to mitigate them. This can wind up with an inconsistent design, and it will almost certainly wind up in a case where other people who come to the design review will be reviewing old, stale copies of the document, which is frustrating for everybody involved. It's best for the principal engineer to come prepared, but not to give their feedback before the design review meeting. The design review should be driven by the designer, not by the principal engineer. It should start with an overview of the design itself and an explanation of its goals, and then it should go through the design artifacts, the documents, sort of page by page, with a chance to give feedback as you go along. Both the designer and the principal engineer should take notes on the discussions that happen throughout the review. These notes should result in a set of action items that are taken, and these action items should be divided up into two categories. The first is blockers, issues that absolutely have to be addressed before the product should be put into production. The second is things which are suggestions or ideas. Those are more optional to be handled at the leisure of the designer. As a principal engineer, remember the maxim, good is good enough. You don't need to come up with the best possible design. A lot of work has already been put into coming up with the design, and the fact is, any design that's ever been created, all it takes is a fresh set of eyes looking at it and you'll come up with a better way of doing things. Instead, they're there to give reassurance that there's not anything big that's missing and to validate that there's not going to be issues in other parts of the product cycle that the designer may not be familiar with, such as servicing the product. Re-review of a design should be extremely rare. Typically, the designer will get a single principal review, and then after they get the set of issues from that, including any blockers, it's really up to the designer what they do with that feedback and whether they want to get anything re-reviewed. Typically, the answer should be no. We talked a little earlier about how the feedback is really optional to take and it's up to the designer. This is absolutely true, but the designer needs to bear in mind if the principal review turns up some sort of awful, egregious problem, and the designer ignores it, and then it surfaces its head in production, that's going to be a problem for the designer because they had a chance to avoid this issue and they didn't. That's the review process. But what sort of things should a principal engineer be looking for, and what sort of things should a designer expect to get feedback on in a design review? The list is long, but here's a few of my favorites. Service lifecycle, data flow and data lifecycle, security, diagnosability, customer focus, and the growth plan for the product if it should need to scale up dramatically. Service lifecycle is everything from the service or software starting up for the very first time to each time it starts up after that, running in steady state, shutting down cleanly and recovering from a dirty shutdown, and being uninstalled if that's an option for the software. Most people spend most of their energy on the design of what the system's going to be doing most of the time, which is steady state. It's running and handling requests and doing whatever it's designed to do. The principal engineer has experience with getting burned by problems with startup or shutdown, with things that are considered invariants not being met, and so on. They can add a lot of value to the design review process by making sure these things have been considered by the designer. Service lifecycle also importantly includes maintenance. This is things like patching the software, updating data schemas, updating data stores and migrating them, and things like this. These are things that are easy to get wrong that can introduce huge outages for a service or absolutely break an application that runs on a client's machine. Data flow and data lifecycle is another important aspect of a design review. Where does data flow? What pieces of data need to be passed between components? How frequently? How much data? Does it need to be buffered if there's a problem with one of the components? What sort of guarantees are made on it? What kind of freshness is required for any data that's being passed around? Does there need to be any sort of authoritative statement about which entity owns the data and whether or not it's fully up to date? These are all questions that may not be obvious on the surface, but things that a principal engineer can help a designer understand the implications of the decisions they made in their software. Security is another huge area for design reviews. Has the designer thought about authentication and authorization for access to the service? If there's multiple services involved in what's being designed, have they thought about how the authorization is going to be proved as transactions flow through the system? Have they thought about changing the authorization permissions that a given user has for accessing things, or revoking either the credentials or those permissions or both? Have they thought about federation? The need to be able to, for example, support Google user IDs in the system. Does the system follow best practices in cryptography and security? Is it trying to invent any security protocols that it shouldn't? Does it need to be compliant with any security certifications, for example, to be deployed to the government or used by the government? These and many more security questions are things that an experienced principal engineer will be able to help identify issues with, among other things, because they've probably bumped into lots of unpleasant problems in their storied past. Another key review area is diagnosability of the system. How is information about the activities being undertaken saved? Is it put into logs? Are those logs uploaded to a central location and easily downloaded? Or are they only on each of the machines that are processing transactions? Is there a way to assemble the logs that are relevant to a given transaction? Have the logs been appropriately secured and anonymized to keep them from leaking client information? Can issues even be diagnosed and reproduced based on the logs? Are there any performance issues that are being induced by logging the data? For example, I've seen cases where standalone devices were logging megabytes of data per second, chewing up a considerable amount of the total storage bandwidth of the device itself. One less common area, but still something that's important for design review from principal engineer, is customer focus. Is the product or the service actually solving a problem that's interesting to customers? Has the designer thought about the problem that it's solving? Do they have a set of requirements that they're adhering to? Have they verified that the product can be used as they intended? You'd be surprised how many products, especially APIs, get designed, implemented, and shipped without anybody actually trying to use it the way a customer would use it instead of making toy problems. This leads to some very bad experiences where a customer can't use the product until the next version is released because it's in the wrong shape and it's incomplete. Finally, growth and scalability of the service or the software. Is there a plan for if the user base grows a great amount or if the usage characteristics are different than expected? For example, in something that stores artifacts from users, what if instead of storing text files, they start storing movies? Will the system be able to cope with that? Is there a way to substitute out storage substrates underneath the system in case there's a problem, or to be able to split and support multiple storage substrates? These are actual problems I've bumped into in the past that have been needs of systems that we've been developing. Another question might be, for data that's stored, is there a way to reap it, to clean out things that are expired and no longer useful? For example, let's say you have a messaging service that has transient messages. They get buffered for a certain amount of time, but is there a reaper that then goes and cleans up any of them that aren't needed anymore? Principals, please remember our role in doing a principal design review is to give feedback on the existing design, not to propose a new design. We want them to be able to ship their product safely with the minimum amount of changes necessary. And designers, please take the feedback that's given in the spirit that it's intended, which is to help you think about things that will let you ship a better product. Product design and implementation is an exercise in time boxing and resource management. As you get feedback, think about what's safe to take as a suggestion and implement, and what should be deferred or what should be ignored, and then make the decisions that are right for your product. And that's my advice. Are you a principal engineer, or have you been reviewed by principal engineers and gotten feedback for your products? Does the process that I described match what you went through? Or are there things that I missed or things that I said you should do that you shouldn't do? I'd love to hear what you think if you got experience with this. Please leave a comment down below. Thanks for taking the time to watch this video and keep on pushing forward. Hi, this is John. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please think about subscribing so you get notified of my future videos. Also, if you are interested, you might want to check out the video I have linked here. Thanks and keep on pushing forward.